piano player, please? Let's pull the whole thing off. Be flat. And well, you say either, I say either, you say neither, I say neither, either, either, neither, neither. Let's call the whole thing off. You say potato, I say potato, you say tomato, I say tomato, potato, tomato, tomato, potato. Let's call the whole thing off. But oh,
thank you. Hi.
Hello, darlings, and welcome to the show.
When I grow up, I'm going to be Kenny Everett. Pathetic, isn't it?
Ev was born in Crosby, at home, in 1944 on Christmas Day, and he was christened Morris James Christopher Cole. He was absolutely beautiful, and he was cherubic. He was inquisitive as a child, and he was always taking things to pieces. Every clock in the house he would take to pieces, but of course he wouldn't know how to put it back together again. And my father bought him a tape recorder, I think to stop him from dismantling every piece of apparatus in the house. And then with a paper round, my brother bought another tape recorder and started to do sound on sound, which I suppose was quite adventurous.
247 on your radio.
And in 1967, a lifelong ambition was fulfilled as Kenny Everett signed up with the corporation he was to christen the Beeb.
The amount of work that Kenny used to put into radio programs was enormous. Kenny would spend hours, days putting programs together, and yet he would do it on a daily basis.
It's just been a... It's... Cut that rocket!
I couldn't really entertain properly. I mean, people got to realise that there was a radio show going on in the other room. But you'd hear him screaming, or he'd run out and he'd come out and he'd say things like, Lee, what do you think would make the sound of an eyeball being ripped from its sockets?
Once I got to know him socially off the ship, it was very obvious that his sexual tendencies were homosexual. And he looked at me as bad. And so he fought it all the way.
Kenny really wanted not to be gay. Life wasn't comfortable as a gay man in those years. Particularly, Kenny being so shy, the knowing this secret, which he had kept to himself for many years, all he wanted to do was be normal, and I think he thought by marrying, that would all fall into...
The reputation for not caring what he said. So he came to the BBC with that kind of reputation, which, of course, is always a mistake, because the BBC has always been pretty careful.
True to form, 3 years after joining Radio 1, Kenny's mouth ran away with him again, and the BBC decided they should part ways.
It's all a con, you know.
Which disc jockey would be complete without a music room? And here's mine.
He had a studio in my flat before we bought a house, and we moved the studio into the farmhouse, and he syndicated radio shows all around England to commercial radio, so he survived.
And he just used to disappear for hours and make all these silly little jingles and all that for a station which I'd never heard of, or vaguely heard of then, called Capital Radio in London. And I just remember we'd be chatting away till midnight or whatever about all sorts of silliness. He'd suddenly go, I'll go and do a jingle, darlings. And he'd go off and make this sort of epic jingle for about an hour. And then the next day he would post the whole show to London. And he just used to say, that's it, darling, that's the Sunday show. And he'd just put it in the postbox at the end of the lane on about a Wednesday. And I thought, what a great life.
Living in a home in the heart of the country.
We were married for about 14 years, and a lot of it was happy. People think because the drama was only highlighted, they forget that a lot of it was great joy, you know? I mean, he was a very good companion, really, when he wasn't depressed. He was very, very affectionate, and he loved walking, he loved everything that was beautiful. He was a very spiritual man, really.
The quieter side of Kenny Everett liked nothing more than to escape on countryside rambles with his bank manager turned friend Eric Gear and his brother George.
The Jolly Revelers.
He had a great love of the countryside
and of nature. I mean, it's been said many times, but he would give God marks out of 10 for various scenes.
And he very often brought God into the conversation.
Oh, look, there's God.
You know, he used to refer to a good scene, isn't God clever?
Kenny's Catholic education had a lasting effect on his life. When he was 12, he spent 2 years studying with the Verona Fathers to become a missionary. It didn't last.
I mean, he was brought up in a good Christian household, not, you know, rigidly strict as sometimes has been portrayed, but, you know, a good Christian way. And I think he was at odds with his own sexuality.
In actual fact, I got him his first boyfriend because I was just sick to death of him tormenting himself. And we were out to dinner with Freddie Mercury, and Ev said to me, as he was always doing, he'd go, oh, he's cute. And he said to me, oh, he's, the waiter's cute. And I thought, oh, I'm just sick of this. So finally I said to the waiter, we're going to a club after this. Do you want to come with us? And he said yes, and that was it. That was his first boyfriend.
Hello, Keith here. Welcome to a show in a glass of its own.
I was surprised when he went to television, because I saw him almost entirely as a radio person. I didn't know whether he could do the kind of fantastical stuff that he was able to do on the radio.
Hello, hello, and welcome to the show. Hello, 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 and welcome to the show. And now it's over there time.
I was strolling down a road the other day, and I got stopped by a member of the Fars. He said, where are you going? I said, Southall. He said, where you been? I said, Vauxhall. He said, what you got in a bag? I said, nothing.
The laughter you hear on those Thames shows is the crew. And Kenny loved it. So it's a very loose, joyful way of working. He moved marvellously well. I mean, he'd never been trained as a dancer or in movement at all, but he was an absolutely brilliant mover on television. Very lithe and contort himself into amazing shapes and leap about.
I think really he should have been born into a huge, muscly body for himself. That's how he would have felt really confident. He didn't think he was handsome and he didn't think he was desirable, which of course he was enormously both. So I think his confidence lacked there a little bit.
Weedy was his favourite word he would use about himself. And, oh yes, I think it was there about being small and maybe leading to a pretty positive approach to life. Shy as he was, when it came to the crunch, you're going to notice me, and people always did.
You sit there with your boils, your pimples, your acne and your piles, and somehow I've grown accustomed to your face. Damn you!
So let's have fun.
Let's now take time to look at some of the great bits from tonight's show. And here they are. Yes, that's what showbiz is all about.
Following a row over censorship with Thames, Kenny took his TV show to the BBC. The budgets grew bigger, the sets grew more lavish, but the humour remained pure Everett.
He wasn't a very political animal. I always said he had a combination of extreme shrewdness and extreme naivety, because the famous incident of him at the Young Conservatives conference.
Michael Winner phoned him up and just said, Ken, you know, good idea, why don't you come to this gig? And I don't know why he said yes, because normally it was the sort of thing he wouldn't have dreamed of going to.
Michael said, you've got to say something outrageous, Kenny, because you'll be on stage and it'll probably be on the news. So I thought, oh, my God, what, something like, let's bomb Russia?
Perfect!
Let's bomb Russia! Let's kick Michael Foot's stick away!
I remember seeing it on the news and thinking, Kenny, this is not a good career move. Because a cutting-edge comedian, which he was at that time, doesn't really really want to be seen endorsing barking mad right-wing policies.
fine, isn't it? Come to the end of an old series, what do you end up with? A silly act and a daft lisp. And a crew that can't pull themselves together.
The television era came to an end after a few happy years at Thames and then 2-3 years at the BBC, and it was like mutual consent.
Pieces going to pieces, and now this.
He was getting disenchanted because he found television a bit wearing and wanted to go back to his first love, radio. Capital Gold,
1548 AM. Kenny used to like cleaning a lot. Well, he was a little obsessive when he went to the studio and he'd pull the microphone down and he'd say, oh, Tony Blackburn's been in here before me, and he'd spray Pledge all over it.
He'd do a little spray and he tidied the whole place up, and only then, when it was all absolutely immaculate, could he go on and do his performance.
Shall I take you on a tour of my flat? OK, hang on, let me a sec. Isn't this fun?
And he collected feather dusters, really glamorous ones that looked like Marlene Dietrich. He had gumptions, but he did, like, clean things.
Groceries, enough to keep me going through a nuclear war. Enough toilet duck to scrub the toilets of the world.
Even after we split up and he was living in another flat, he used to come round and he would follow me and stand and talk to me in the kitchen. And while he was talking, he'd clean the kitchen. When I married my present husband, he was our best man. And he arrived the night before I got married and spent 2 hours trying to talk me out of getting married. Because basically, I think he would have liked his cake and eaten it. He would have liked me to be there as well as in being gay.
However, in later years, Kenny was to criticise Lee and their marriage publicly. Sadly, their unique relationship soured, and for the rest of Kenny's life, the two were to maintain a frosty distance.
This time we always made the pieces fit, didn't we, boys?
I know there's a very sad period when he first sort of came out. I think his timing was quite extraordinary. I seem to remember it being about 3 days after Rock Hudson died or something. I remember Kenny coming into the building in tears that these builders had been shouting abuse at him, like, sort of from round the corner where he lived. He'd walk past this building site for, you know, 2 or 3 years from his flat. They're all going, hello, Kenny, all right, little Ken. And that day they were sort of, gah, you poofter, and all this. And he was really upset by it.
Kenny's parents adore Kenny, and he was always worried about hurting their feelings and being a disappointment. But in fact, they didn't mind. And the wonderful thing about going to Australia with Kenny to be reunited with his parents, he hadn't seen them for a while because they'd gone to Australia, was seeing them, you know, all throw their arms around each other and having all this had been in the press while they'd been away. And it was a moment where it was just so obviously it didn't matter. And Kenny said, oh, to think I'd worried all those years and they'd loved me anyway.
I'm the Lone Ranger. Are you feeling tired and listless, out of sorts? Can't face up to your problems? Wish there was something you could do to pick you up, put that smile back on your face, and make life worth living again? Why not do what I did? Get Tonto!
We got this new boyfriend called Nikolai. And Nikolai happened to have a boyfriend anyway called Pepe, a Spanish man. So there was three of them in that relationship.
Kenny adored Nikolai. He found him exasperating sometimes, but there was a very strong bond there. He was terribly fond of him, in love with him, no question. I remember once saying something slightly derogatory about Nikolai, and Kenny shot me an absolute, you know, dagger's look. You know, do not mess with my man.
Nikolai had a deadly charm. Yes, Nikolai was a very charming man. Charmed birds off trees and anything off anybody or anything, yeah.
Nikolai was one of the first, and I remember coming away from visiting him in hospital in London with Ev, and Ev said, well, I'll probably be next. And it was a few years before he discovered he was HIV.
He admitted he would have preferred keeping quiet about being HIV positive, but his message was that he was feeling as zany as ever.
I got 3 hugs in the street this morning.
After the announcement that he was HIV positive, he went on a health regime. He joined a gym, vitamin pills, he worked out. He was really in great, great spirits.
On our last walk,
Kenny took along a video camera. I suspect he knew that that was his last walk. I suspect he did.
Yeah, if he did, it certainly didn't come out because he was there to have fun.
You could see the way he would look at some of the scenery, and he could go very serious when he stood and looked around over a dial or a vale or looking up at a hill. I have a feeling he realised it weren't going to be many more walks, if any, and there wasn't.
I guess because of his humour, his indomitable spirit, we thought he would be one of those who remained HIV positive forever, and so we were, of course, shattered when he rang and said, it's developed, I have full-blown AIDS. We were very sad.
A year before Kenny died, the radio industry recognised his outstanding contribution to broadcasting with the prestigious Sony Award.
It's very difficult to talk to someone who you know is dying, who you're tremendously fond of. And I thought, I don't ever want to see, like, an ill Kenny, you know, a sort of skeletal Kenny Everett or whatever. And he wouldn't think about it. And he'd say, oh, darling, we're doomed. We're all going down, darlings, and all this. And it actually lightened everything. And you could chat and say, how are you really? He'd say, oh, I'm OK, I'm a bit, you know, a bit worried about pneumonia or something. But actually, he was very upfront about it. For basically a puny, quite sort of timid little guy, he was very brave about death.
He didn't feel sorry for himself. He didn't feel well, and he didn't like the fact that he was falling apart, as he'd say. But as he did start to fall apart, we had lunch one day and we agreed not to see each other because he never saw me without my makeup. It was just my thing. And he didn't want me to see him, he said, in the equivalent without his, which was him looking ill and falling apart. So we had lunch and we kissed each other goodbye on his doorstep, and that was the last time I saw him alive.
There was no kind of big goodbye. We didn't know it was going to be the last goodbye. But as I was leaving, I remember him saying, I think I've had enough now, so I think I've made it to 50, and that's quite a milestone, but I think I've had enough.
Life is funny. It's odd. It's a rather amusing joke, really. I mean, you just got to get on with it and make it as much fun for yourself and other people as possible. I mean, sure, no regret-a-reen. You know what I mean? If I ever do die, I think as I'm hoiked aloft in a ray of God's lovely sunbeam, I think I'd like this to be on the gramophone as I go.
Under the care of his sister Kate, Kenny died on April the 4th, 1995. In the last weeks of his life, he was reconciled with the church. And as a final promise, Kate arranged the Requiem Mass Kenny wanted so badly, but thought he could never have.
I think the funeral did reflect the real Kenny Everett. He loved pomp, ceremony, music. And it was what he asked for, and it was what he got.
The sun was shining in the church that day, and the sun was shining through the stained glass window straight onto the coffin. It was quite uncanny.
Well, Jo Gurnett said afterwards that she expected the lid to pop up and for him to go da-da-da-da-da.
I still have enduring memories of him bending my microphone on blankety-blank. Didn't like it at the time, of course, but distance lending enchantment to the view, you see.
He was dichotomous. He was many personalities. He was immensely talented, of course. He was great fun to be with.
Well, Becky definitely needs to be taken to one side, but Steve's finding his wife is digging her heels in. He's got his work cut out next in Coronation Street, and at 9, Extraordinary Families continues with Babies Behind Bars.